everyone, and welcome back to the Secure Future Initiative Tech Tip Show, the show where we talk to Microsoft security experts about how you can implement SFI recommendations in your environment. My name's Sarah Young. I'm a principal security advocate here at Microsoft, and I've got my co-host Michael with me again. Michael, want to tell everyone who you are?
Yeah, I'm Michael Howard. I'm a senior director in the Microsoft Red Team. And in this particular video, we have our guests, Clay and Shazad, who are here to talk to us about managing devices with Intune and implementing conditional access. And this is all underneath the tenants and isolation pillar. So gentlemen, welcome to the video. We'd like to take a moment and just introduce yourself to our audience.
Thanks, Michael. Hey everyone, I'm Clay Taylor, based out of Redmond, Washington, part of the Intune product group. I'm a principal architect, and my focus is mostly on zero trust and end-to-end security. But today I'm here to talk to you specifically about Intune compliance policy and conditional access. And Shazad?
I'm a partner architect on Intune team. Primarily manage security from design, implementation, and then operations as well. And here to have a good conversation about securing devices.
Awesome.
So I'm going to ask probably the dumbest question, but there you go. Why? I mean, why isn't this important? Why is endpoint protection important? Why is managing devices important? And how does conditional access play into all that?
Great question. We have in the past talked about managing identity, securing identity, and everyone knows about that protection of identities, whether it's passwords or any other credentials, that how critical that is. But equally important are the devices on which those identities are used to access corporate resources, whether it's SharePoint, OneDrive, emails. So as much as we want to make sure that we are protecting identities, management of devices to make sure that the devices themselves are secure, where those identities are going to be used, the data is going to be accessed, becomes equally important, because at some point that becomes the next level of attack for attackers to compromise identities. Conditional access, really powerful tool to make sure that devices that are not compliant are not able to access certain resources. And Clay can go in a lot more details about how conditional access can play here.
Sure. So thanks, Shazad. Yeah, so, you know, one of the things that I do, that I talk to people a lot about is zero trust and how conditional access is really the kind of the cornerstone of our entire zero trust story at Microsoft. And I'm going to show you on my screen how conditional access ties everything together. If you look at our capability mapping, this is all of our Microsoft products laid out on NIST Zero Trust capability mapping chart. And if you see here in the middle, where you have intra conditional access, this is the policy enforcement point or policy enforcement engine for our entire security stack. And so what conditional access is there to do is basically serve as a gate or a gateway for all of your apps, for your identities, for all of your access decisions. Basically, it's going to serve as that gateway to determine whether or not, you know, in this case, a device is healthy and compliant before giving access to those resources. And now we're going to show you how to actually configure this in the Intune console. So if you open your Intune console, and go to devices, and then windows, click on compliance. Here, we're gonna create a new compliance policy. We're gonna choose Windows 10 or later. We're gonna name this Windows Compliance. And we're gonna start configuring the policy. The first section talks about custom compliance. So, if there are things that you wish to require, you know, for access to corporate resources, let's say you wanted to require a certain, third-party application or VPN product or third-party firewall application, or, you know, you wanted to require a particular value to be set on a device before giving access to resources, this is where you can actually create a custom compliance policy to go out and one, have a detection script that goes out and detects for that particular feature or app or policy. And then you can actually create a compliance policy that will say, hey, I'm going to block access to resources if this particular functionality is not present or this particular app is not present. Now that we've named our compliance policy, we're going to go through and set settings to actually prevent a user from accessing resources unless certain criteria are met. The first of these is in the device health section. It's BitLocker. And we absolutely want to require BitLocker for these devices and for these users to get access to resources. Second up is Secure Boot. Secure Boot is just going to make sure that this device is only going to boot running recognized and secure software that is actually vetted by the manufacturer of the device that is booting. Finally, we have Code Integrity. And Code Integrity, this is one that you may or may not want to implement for all users. We mostly see this implemented for things like our secure admin workstations, but this is going to basically say, hey, I'm only going to let applications and code that has been vetted and, you know, has actually been attested as safe to actually run in my environment and to run these devices. This can have some adverse effects depending on how the device is being used and by whom. So that's why we say, you know, it's up to you as to whether or not you want to, look at running this for all users or just for your secure admin workstations.
Yeah, as an old Windows security guy, I'm happy to see those three there because those three are more secure than the sum of the parts. And I think that's really important people understand that. And I do agree that that last one, the code integrity, you're going to use that for highly restricted workstations, not for general purpose workstations, I doubt.
Yeah, great totally point. Agree with that. Yeah.
Next up, we have our device properties. And this is where you're going to set things like your minimum OS version, your maximum OS version, if you wanted to prevent betas from running. The one thing I want to call out here is hygiene. And, you know, compliance policy hygiene is something that gets overlooked. I talk to customers all the time. One of the things that I work on is that I have been working on is a Zero Trust workshop. And as part of that workshop, we actually go and look at the compliance policies for our customers. And I actually go through them with the customer as part of that workshop. It's something that I find over and over again is that, you know, everything looks great. And we'll start looking, you know, at the details of the compliance policy. And I'll say, you know, that operating system hasn't, you know, been in support for security updates for a couple of years now that you have set as your minimum OS version. You know, why is that still set to this older version? And the response I received 9 out of 10 times is, well, that was set by someone who set it 5 years ago, or that was set by someone who's no longer working at our company. And it's something that, you know, it's you have to go in and update these things. It's, you know, it's something that we're finding that is one of the biggest misses that we see in our Zero Trust workshops is that people just don't go back and revisit these settings. And so they have a minimum OS version that was set 5 years ago, and it's really not protecting you from a lot of the, you know, threats that cannot be prevented even on some of these older operating systems. So that's why I recommend at least every 3 to 6 months come in here and just do a health check. Make sure that you're checking, you know, your minimum operating system versions to make sure they're up to date and it's a supported version of Windows that you're entering here. Some of the other items that, you know, I'll just call out here, things that you know, probably pretty obvious, but things that you definitely need to require are things like requiring a password, blocking simple passwords on these devices, setting things like requiring, you know, a device level firewall, requiring TPM chips. These are things that you definitely want to consider when you're creating your security policy, your compliance policy, you know, and really your conditional access policy in general. You have to go through and consider each one of these items. Next, we're going to require Microsoft Defender anti-malware. On top of that, we're also going to make sure that we are turning on the requirement for security intelligence being updated automatically for Defender anti-malware, and also turning on real-time protection. Finally, we're going to set a minimum risk score of medium. And what this does is it's going to check with Microsoft Defender for Endpoint and only allow devices that are at or below the minimum risk score before that user or that device gets access to resources. So in this case, we're setting it to medium. So as long as the device is at or below the medium risk score and Defender for Endpoint, then the user will have access to resources. If they are at a high risk score, they will get blocked from accessing corporate resources using conditional access policy. One thing we didn't cover at the beginning was custom compliance. If you have something that you want to require for your users on their Windows devices that is not one of these pre-configured settings or available settings out of the box, you can actually write a custom compliance script, a discovery script, to go out and look for something on that device. It could be something like a third-party VPN product, a third-party firewall rule, any setting on that device, basically anything that you can write a detection script for, you can go out and look for on that device and create a compliance policy that will not only go check for those things, you can actually specify instructions for the user on how to remediate it if they don't meet that compliance requirement.
So Clay, with the discovery script, what's the format of that script? What's it written in?
Great question, Sarah. So the discovery script is actually a PowerShell script. The remediation text or basically the remediation portion of the compliance policy is actually going to be JSON.
Got it. Should have known.
Shabbat, anything you want to add there?
No, as Clay has shown, there are lots and lots of knobs available. But really, it can be as customizable by using a custom compliance script as you want. For majority of the customers, the default options that are already available should just work. But if there is something really customized about the environment, then you also have an option of using custom compliance.
Great point.
Right.
So now we have our compliance policy. And this is where, this is something that I've also seen over and over again, where I'll be going through with customers and saying, oh, your compliance policy looks so awesome. And then we go and look at their conditional access policy. And so many times I've run into this where they have a great compliance policy. It's, looking for not compliant devices, but their conditional access policy isn't actually blocking not compliant devices, which kind of defeats the purpose of even having a compliance policy. So we're going to go through and show you right now how to go through and create a conditional access policy to actually block not compliant devices. And we've made that easier with a new public preview setting that we have. But if you open up your endpoint security blade in Intune, and then we scroll down to conditional access, you're going to see a fairly new section here called Create New Policy from Templates. So I'm going to click that, and you're going to see an option here, and this is in preview, but it says require MDM enrolled and compliant device to access cloud apps for all users. All you have to do is click this button. If you want to download the JSON file for this, you can do this here. And we're just going to click review and create. You're going to see here that it's currently set to report only. So this is not going to actually enforce anything at this time. It's just going to report to you whether or not this device would have been blocked in case this conditional access policy is applied to users. And it's going to also target all users, excluding current users, and also excluding directory synchronization account roles. We're going to talk to you in just a few minutes about some other reasons why exclusions are important here. But for the sake of this demo, we're just going to walk through, and now I'm just going to click create to create this policy.
So I noticed on the prior screen that there were three options. One was like enforced, I think not enforced, but the third one was really interesting, which was report only. I mean, my guess is that's what we'd recommend most people do, at least at the very beginning, to make sure nothing gets blocked. Right? Just see, you know, what is going to get enforced and what is not going to get enforced. Is that fair?
Right. That one.
Right. That's probably the thing that you want to start with, report-only mode, just to see what the effect will be. And likely, we want to do that anytime when we are making any changes to an existing policy as well. We want to see what the impact will be. Sometimes impact is just not very obvious. So report only helps a lot with making sure that an IT department is not breaking the productivity of the organization.
So that begs the next question, right? Is, let's say I did a report, everything looks good, then I turn it on and I enforce this thing, and all of a sudden people don't have access for whatever reason, like I didn't test them or something. Is there a break glass solution in here as well?
Excellent. And we see on play screen right now the excluded users and excluded roles. That's exactly for that purpose, that we can designate folks who are not where these policies are not going to be enforced, or roles where these policies are not going to be enforced. And primarily, we want to make sure that we have a way to get back into the system if everybody is locked out. Now, going back to Clay's earlier point about hygiene, this is another area where we have seen customers struggle with it, because something does not work and people add a user to excluded users group, and that excluded users group does not get cleaned up. So going back to the hygiene point, that's another area where we want to make sure that the right users are excluded and for the right reasons.
So it sounds like every few months, go back, check the policies, and also check who's on that exclusion list.
So we've learned a lot on this episode about Intune and conditional access. Obviously, there's a lot more to learn about. So if you want to learn more about how you can implement SFI learnings in your environment, go to aka.ms/SFI tech tips. Shahzad and Clay, thank you so much for joining us. It's been a pleasure. For all of you tuning in, thanks for joining us, and join us next time on another episode of SFI Tech Tips. See you later.